Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN Podcast. I'm your host, Billy, as always. And this edition, I am joined by the Modern Day Diva herself, Ashley Vega. Welcome to the show.
Thank you.
I'm super excited for this one. I'm doing really great. I've got a packed lineup of guests. People still want to speak to me after all these episodes of dinosaur shenanigans and just nonsense. But we're still going. So thank you for agreeing to take part. When I was going through, when I'm looking for guests, I really just go through my follow list now. So I go through the DMs and you were there. I was like, I have to speak to Ashley Vega because it'll be unlike anything else because we'll speak about divas. And as a young lad back in the day when divas were a big thing, I was quite a fan of them, maybe for different reasons, but you know, I was still a fan of them regardless. So before we go any further though, boring questions to kick off with, how did you get into pro wrestling? What got you hooked?
So I remember growing up, I have an older brother. He introduced me to it because he was a massive like wrestling fan. So I always kind of knew what it was. And then I remember the first match I've seen on TV was Trish Stratus versus Mickie James. And I was just like, oh my God, I didn't know girls did this. And I just was constantly watching like Raw. I would always watch it. Like it used to be on like Sky on like a Saturday or Sunday morning. And I always used to watch it because I never stayed up late. But and then I just became obsessed since then.
Pretty good duo to start off with, Trish and Mickie, because they had amazing series, what, 2005, 6, something like that, remember then?
Yeah, I remember being about 7 years old. Yeah, I was about then. And that was when when Trish was leaving and stuff. And I just remember that was like the first kind of two women I watched. And I was just so obsessed with them. I just thought they were so cool and just so entertaining.
So you start watching at 7, and then I've got from previous interviews you've done that you actually started training at 14. So that's so what made you decide to finally go from, right, I'm watching these wrestlers, I want to try and do it myself?
Yeah, the thing is, I didn't know it was a big thing in the UK. And I wasn't aware of it. And I remember, I don't know how I came across it, but I just remember looking up like wrestling schools. Because I heard about like Grado and things like that. And I was like, well, obviously it's a thing in the UK. I remember looking up schools and I just found one near me. And I just went and like, I was never an athletic child. I was quite the fat child in school. I was the one that would, get fake notes to hand in at PE. Like I hated that, and I don't know why I did it, but I just was like, wrestling's the only sport that I like. And the first day was hard. Like, oh my God, I was like, oh my God, all this cardio. I just, the fat kid inside me didn't enjoy it, but it was fun, you know. So that's why I stuck at it.
Yeah, I wasn't the fat kid. I just didn't want to do anything. My cardio was running down to the chipper at lunchtime and then running back to school afterwards. That's it, cardio done for the day. I'm not doing cross country or any of that rubbish.
Oh no.
So not an athletic background, but so what was you said it was like, oh no, when you got there for the first time.
Yeah.
But, so the school you went at was Matt's, it would be Matt's initially. You would have started on. So what was it like taking your first bumps on that?
See, to be honest, it was hard, but it was you just got used to it. I think that it's weird when you're not in a ring all the time, because I think it was the only school at the time that never had a ring, which was weird. Other people thought it was, but it was a good way to learn. I never went in a ring until my first match, which was probably a bad idea, but it's just how it happened. Tough, but it was fun.
Yeah, I was speaking to Krieger pretty much because he also came from either one of the same schools, and he was saying it was good because you got to learn, you would be able to, if anything went wrong, you'd know how to do to wrestle. But the other side, all these people from other schools are running the ropes and looking all fancy and flashy, and they were standing there going, I don't know how to do that yet, so I'll just stand.
It's weird though, because I feel like I've noticed how people from like the main schools all wrestle differently. You know, I feel like where like me and like Craig came from, it's all very entertainment and wrestling. And then when you go to like Source, you know, they have like the they're more flashy, I feel. And then you go to like the Asylum and they wrestle their own way. I feel like we all have our own style. Do you know what I mean? Because we're all trained differently. You can kind of tell what school we all came from. It's weird, but it's just how I see it.
Absolutely. Well, I mean, in the school you're at as well, it had heavy links to things like the camps and that. So it was it was very much a entertainment business for the families. Did you ever do any of the camps at all?
No, I didn't actually. I never actually did. I've always wanted to, but I never got the chance to do it. And then obviously now I've not done it. So I've always wanted to, because it's I've went to a lot of the shows. I was always there helping out or just there, but I never got the chance to the opportunity to wrestle them, which was quite sad that I probably won't be able to do it again. But it's such a fun atmosphere, because it was all very, you know, child and entertainment. You know, it was fun to be there, but no, I never got the opportunity to do it.
Absolutely. I mean, to be honest, I mean, when it comes to wrestling coming back, I think camps might be the second thing. That galas would be the first, I would think.
Yeah.
I mean, camps would probably be second, because it's a core group, and you're getting a smaller crowd. I don't know. Who knows at this point? Because we're still in the world of pandemics and COVID. Right. So, who are your favourites growing up then? Of course, Trish and Mickey, who you started watching. I mean, and people are listening, you're still 14 when you started wrestling. So, who are your favourites growing up?
I had so many. So, see, the thing was, when I was like 14, it was like 2013, right? So, I never really grew up with the whole Attitude Era at all. The only reason I got into it was my brother, like, was a big fan, and he had hundreds of DVDs from, like, you know, 90s, 2000s, because that's when he grew up watching it. So when I was a bit older, he gave me them all, and that was all I watched, because there was no network then. I just watched hundreds of DVDs, and because I liked wrestling, I was like, oh, I'll watch these, and that's how I, like, found out about all these, how different it was before. That's how I found that out, because I didn't grow up in that time. And I was like, oh my god, like, it's crazy, like, how different it was. And I had so many favourites. So obviously Trish and Mickey are up there, Victoria, and then from back in the day, like, people think that I'm just joking when I say, oh, I loved Tori Wilson, but I did, because I thought, like, she was so entertaining. Like, the storyline with her and Dawn Marie, you'll never see anything like that again.
Oh, no. Like,
no,
you will not.
But like, it's so fun. Like, it was entertaining. I know a lot of people will disagree, but you know, I liked watching it, because I thought it was fun. It was like a sitcom. Like, it was so good.
I mean, yeah, you got to take. I mean, I loved it as well, obviously. Because I was, what was that? 2004? I think 2005. So I was 14, 15. So it was right. Tori Wilson was absolutely the person at my age that I need to see, for reasons. But it's all subjective, because I mean, the older I get, the more I realise the Attitude Era and that was wholly overrated. And it was the time, WrestleMania 17 onwards, that's your sweet spot, and it gets better from there, even through the tough times of weird stuff. But I mean, speaking of your era, like the ones, Trish, Mickey, of course, Victoria was amazing. I think she was one of the proper legit wrestlers. And she started as off as one of Godfather's hoes.
Yeah. I think the Trish and Mickey was the first kind of like story I got involved in, because it was the first match I watched. And then when I was a bit older, I would always go back and watch older stuff. So maybe I was like 14, 13, I would always go back and watch Trish's stuff because she was my favourite. And I watched the whole, like, Trish and Mickey storyline from beginning to end, and it was so long, but it was, like, it was so, I genuinely can't think of another storyline that's like it, that's so dramatic, but so real, and, like, you're just hooked, and you want to know what happens next, and their matches were just so good as well, like, everything about that was just so well done, I just loved it, so, yeah, favourite.
Yeah, I mean, it also if my memory serves me correctly, it also introduced so many other wrestlers during that whole. Like I say, it was a long storyline. So you had, I think, Ashley Massaro was involved. Beth Phoenix
turned up as well. Yeah.
Yeah. I've got a feeling Christy Hemme was somewhere involved in there as well.
Yeah.
So it was. Yeah, people give it a bad rap, but you like what you like, and if you like divas, you like the divas. That's how it is. One, of course, being Stacey Keibler, of course, being another favourite of mine in my youth as well. So you said you went back. So two of the ones that you went back to and caught your eye, obviously, would have been The Cat and Terry Runnels.
Yeah.
So what is it about them and the divas in general that really...
I just think, like, I know a lot of people, you know, kind of think I'm just joking about it and stuff, which, yeah, but... Like, I will generally go and watch, like, old pay-per-views and watch the stuff that they've done, because to me it was funny. Like, I just think it's so funny and ridiculous that they would have stupid matches, like a gravy bowl match. Like, that's insane. But, you know, it's not wrestling, but it's entertainment. And I just thought it was so fun. Like, and I would love to do stuff like that. And I'm like, yeah, it's not wrestling, but... It's just different, and I know people think it's stupid and it's silly and they were making fun of the women, but, like, to me it doesn't really, like, matter, because say if that's something I enjoy doing, I should be allowed to go and do it, because it's, you know, my choice. I want, that's, you know, people have their style, women want to go and do, you know, all the stuff the guys do, like steel cage matches and hardcore matches, which is great, and I think it's so good how far we've come. But, like, if I enjoy that, then I should be able to do that. Do you know what, like, it's just everyone has their own taste, but that's just mine. I'm just different from everyone else, and I don't think there's anything wrong with that. I just think everyone has their own tastes and what they enjoy and what they don't enjoy. But I'm just weird.
No, like I said, the weird thing about wrestling is it's such a weird community as well, whereas it's open, but it's also gatekeeped at the same time. Yeah. It's like, oh, you can like anything. Oh, you like that, though. Oh, you know, you should like that. It's like, who cares? It's they're still watching it at the end of the day. I mean, people go absolutely insane for things in Japan, like fireworks being shot out of their crotch, stuff like that. Why can't you like gravy bowl matches? I mean,
exactly.
If I was watching it back in my youth, I did have to turn it over if my mum came into the room, because, you know, that's not wrestling.
It's a bit dodgy.
It's a bit weird. But but other than that, it's just one of those things. So you started wrestling at 14, which you said you're the chubby kid growing up. So that sounded really like just a statement, right? Like, well, you're a chubby kid. You started at 14. So how long did it take you to kind of push your cardio and get you a bit ring ready from that point?
Well, after a year of wrestling, I was doing shows. Because as soon as I turned 16, I started doing shows. So it took a while. I'm still not the most athletic person in the world. You know, that's why I push for the gravy bowl matches, because I don't need to do anything. Like... no, but genuinely, like, for example, I remember a while back I debuted for Discovery with Angel Hayes, and that was a big thing for me, because Discovery is, like, one of those companies that's, you know, you have to kind of push yourself. There's lots of big names on there, so to have, like, me and Angel Hayes, who'd wrestled, like, you know, each other on like kids shows all the time, and no one knew who we were. It was like, oh, this is scary. And I also need to actually, you know, I can't wrestle like I would wrestle in front of a crowd in Maryhill. You know, it's different. So when we were training for that match, that was when I really had to push myself, because it was proper wrestling. And I was like, this is so different to what I'm used to. And I was like, oh, I was so nervous for it because I'd never wrestled like that. But it made me, like, you know, I say I always, like, love, like, the silly matches and things. But I genuinely do love proper wrestling as well. And that's why I enjoyed that match so much, because it was one of the only times I got to proper show that I could wrestle as well. And that was probably, like, one of the first times I was like, oh, my God, I can actually wrestle. I don't need to do all this stuff. But the only reason I do it all is because I enjoy it, but I can also wrestle when I need to. You know, it's good to have that diversity, I guess.
Absolutely. Yeah. It's weird. Discovery seems the kind of place that would be all in for a gravy bowl match as well. They had a zombie lumberjack match. So, I mean, gravy bowl seems to be the next step.
I'll need to get on to Alan about that, but I'm not sure how I feel opposed of my decision.
I mean, throw some beer, maybe put a beer pool, Martina. It could all work. That's it, Alan. If you're watching this, we've got it. This is the title change that you need.
The turn match.
Exactly. So Discovery. So it's one of those companies. You've had pretty. I mean, I was going through your matches because I trust the Germans at CageMatch.net for all my information on matches, which. It goes well that it doesn't at the same time, because Mike Musso was not trained by Dan B. Severn. Who knew? But I was going through your matches from 2017. You had matches with Sam Reed Taylor, which she's obviously a veteran of Scottish wrestling in general. A lot of matches with Angel Hayes, of course. You guys were kind of like attached to the hip. If there was a match on the show, it was going to be Angel and Ashley were going to be facing off. And then you were at SWA very quickly against Lana Austin, who of course is now in NXT UK. So what was it like getting out there and actually being in front of a crowd? You come across to me as quite a shy person as well. So what was it like getting in front of a crowd?
People say that. I would say I'm a shy person, but when I'm wrestling, I'm a completely different person. For like wrestling in front of like you know, different crowds, like shows that I really felt more confident in doing more of was the Fierce Females shows. Again, they're over 18, and it was just a different atmosphere, and I thought that was, you know, I felt more confident, and because I had to push myself, it was an over 18s, it wasn't a kids show, you know, they weren't there to watch like John Cena, they were there to watch like proper wrestling. So I feel so much more confident. I mean, I say that now, when shows get back, I'll be absolutely like crapping myself because it's been a very long time. I think wrestling in front of like over 18s and kids shows, like, you have to be different. So it's I think I've just gained so much more confidence wrestling in front of so many different crowds. So I do seem like a shy person. I am, but as soon as, you know, I'm wrestling, I'm not. I'm completely different.
It's you can't really get away with it. The come on guys clap. They'll just turn around and go, no. Make me want to cheer you. So very quickly, again, it's just within like your first year or so, you end up going down to Eve, is one of the biggest women's only promotions in Europe, dare I say the world, teaming with Roxy. So again, a lot of this will be what were your feelings involved with that, because there's so many little like matches I really want to kind of to pick out. But what was it like going in front of a crowd like Eve, because it's all women's wrestling, so there's a lot of competition involved.
So when Eve came about, I only found out that I was doing the show the night before, and I flew out that morning, to London because I was a replacement for, I can't even remember who it was now, was meant to be doing the show, and they couldn't do it. So I got asked the night before if I could fly out to London in the morning. And I was like, yeah, like, sure. But I was so scared because I went with Sammy Jane, and obviously she's was wrestled there loads of times. But it was very different. Eve is a very different, you know, place to what I was used to then. I never really had done like anything like that. And, you know, Eve's more very indie style, which I wouldn't pride myself on. Just, you know, it's not my most comfortable place to be. But, you know, I obviously agreed to it because I was like, oh, this is amazing. But then, you know, when I got there, fun fact, Eve was the first place I wrestled and I came out with my glasses on, and it was an accident. And people liked it, and that's how they remembered me. People were tweeting like, oh, the girl with the glasses, and I was like, oh, I'm gonna do this from now on. And I think that's the only thing that got me through, is people were more focused on if I was going to wrestle with my glasses on than I'm actual wrestling, which is probably a good thing. So,
oh, weird thing for people to pick up on, because yeah, things like when I went to Rock and Wrestle with my wife, she saw Ravy Davey for the first time and came out with the hat. And she went, this nigga wrestled with the hat on, is he? And he wrestled with the hat on. And then afterwards, she was just like, I can't believe that guy wrestled with a hat on. So it's like, it's such a weird thing just to pick out.
Yeah.
But that glasses thing kind of led you back to Discovery for possibly one of your, I would say, one of your biggest matches against Veda Scott, who, of course, is also famously a glasses wearer.
Yeah.
I'm just going through your matches here. I mean, you're against folk that are now moved on to NXT UK, like Valkyrie and Lana, as I said. But what was it like going in with an import talent like Veda Scott?
Yeah, I'd never wrestled like an import before, and I remember when Alan told me about the match, it made sense because I think he did it because we were both, you know, we could play off each other well. And I was really worried, but Veda was just one of the nicest people ever. You know, I learned a lot from it, and that was probably one of like my favourite matches because it was just fun. I didn't worry a lot because I just felt comfortable because we were both confident and we were both knew what we were doing, and we just had like fun, you know, playing around with each other with the whole glasses kind of thing. It was one of my favorite matches. It was just so much fun. I'd like to wrestle Veda again. I'd never wrestled, like I said, an import before, but it was just so much fun. So yeah.
It's probably gonna be a stupid question then, but the glasses that you wore for Eve and subsequently once you've wrestled afterwards, wearing your glasses, is that now just what does that's your wrestling glasses now? The ones that you just keep aside? Yeah. Or do you actually still use them?
Yeah, I've got like a million pairs of glasses. The thing with Eve, I didn't have my contacts at the show. I usually wear contact lenses, but I didn't have them. And I think I just kept my glasses on like all of backstage, and then I was going out and I was like, oh, like I just forgot. I was like, oh, I've just not put my contacts in. I completely forgot because I was probably just so nervous. But it worked. So I still have those glasses somewhere. They have one leg on them now. So I can't use them anymore. I broke them at one of the shows. What show was it? Generally can't remember, but I broke them at a show once. I can't remember what one it was. But I got them back and they were broke. So they're still somewhere. But yeah.
It's probably placed somewhere somewhere in a cupboard.
Yeah.
I mean, with so many great wrestlers nowadays in Scotland, male and female, it's always nice to... We're spending a lot of time speaking about glasses more than I thought. I didn't even write that down as a note. It's nice to have like something that just sets you apart from the rest. And if it's glasses, it's glasses. That's just that's what it is. And our match had a Discovery, which again is against big bigger names. Ring of Honor's session with Martina, who we mentioned earlier, for this beer bowl match that's eventually going to happen for Discovery. So you're against her and Emily Hayden. So again, going into a match with a big character like Martina, and obviously Emily is just another character in herself. Was that another match that you wanted to go in and just prove yourself and show that you're still one, you're one of them, one of the top wrestlers there?
So with that match, I think what the idea was because me, Emily and Martina were like, with Discovery, were like the three big characters. Because I remember on that show they had like Sammy Jean and Angel Hayes, which are proper, you know, wrestlers. And then you had like the big characters in the triple threat, which was, you know, we just had a laugh. We were drinking out of Martina's cans and pretending like we were steaming. And it was absolutely disgusting because she came out with Tennent's, and that is the most vile drink ever. And me and like Emily were drinking it during the match, and I was like, I cannot believe I just drank that because that's disgusting. But it was just, it was such a fun match. Like, that was probably one of my favourites, because I get on with Emily so well, and we got to wrestle Martina. So it was just a lot of fun.
Steph, definitely, I can see you being friends with Emily just because of your outside of wrestling passions, which we will speak about, of course, because that's what you've been doing for the last year when it comes to just being getting your name out there. So during the lockdown and everything like that, so you started off in Glasgow and that, and you also did a bit of Fierce Females, am I right? Did a bit of Fierce Females training under Sammy Jane.
Yeah.
And then you moved on, and during the non-contact training, you did a little bit of FPWA as well. So who do you think who's been the most influential in your wrestling and your just in-ring style?
I feel like Sammy Jane had like a big, huge part, because before I started, as soon as I started training with her, I became so much more confident. And I feel like it was just because she was a girl and she understood, you know, what it was like. And because I'd never, you know, before, I'd never really trained with girls. And then with Sammy, it was an all-girls school. So it was different, because training with guys, it's good, but I feel like guys might be scared to hurt me, because I was just a young girl, you know, and like I didn't really, no one really wanted to hurt me. That's how I felt. And then as soon as we started training with Sammy, like it was different, and we got to have like work on like proper move sets and what style we wanted to do. And now recently, well, must be about a year now, I've been training under Joe Hendry. So he's helped quite a lot with my character and things like that. He's, you know, he's a big character himself. And so I started training there. I can't even remember when now, but it must have been about a year ago. I've been training under Joe, and I still do, which is good because he has, you know, so much knowledge, and he knows a lot about character. So I feel like Sammy's really helped me ring style wise, like in the ring, but Joe's helped me more with character and things like that. So it's probably those two are the biggest ones.
Yeah, oh, definitely. As soon as you said Joe Hendry, I was like, perfect, because his character is his bread and butter. I mean, he's not that bad at wrestling as well, but he's been able to do a lot just for his character work. But one of your first forays really into putting out your character was King's Road Warriors, on YouTube, which I watched intently. So it was yourself, Angel Hayes, and then Jesse Santana, who's now Shea Renee. And you're with Aspen Faith and Sammy Jane doing all that. What was that like? Because that's more of a in front of camera character work. You're not relying on an audience to feedback at that moment in time. So what was that experience like for you?
Yeah, I don't even know how that came about. Like, I genuinely can't remember how we even came up with the idea. I think what it was is, you know, Aspen wanted to do like a kind of, you know how they had the NXT and they had the wrestler and the rookie, kind of thing. We wanted to do something like that. So he asked, you know, me, Angel, and then Jesse at the time, if we wanted to do it, and he was going to bring in like Lewis and Sammy to be our coaches, and we were like, you know, why not? So it started off just like what was it? Stupid challenges every week, because in NXT they were doing not even like wrestling related challenges with their rookies. Like, it was just so ridiculous the stuff they were doing. And that's kind of where the idea came from. And it was just fun. We just would go to the school and we would have ideas to film. You know, we would just, it was like, people were like, oh, it wasn't even planned. Like, who won the challenges? That was never planned. It was genuinely what happened. I remember one of them being the questions, and it was like all these wrestling questions, and I had no idea. Me and Angel were just like, yeah, I don't know. Like, it wasn't planned. It was just, we would just go and mess about for like an hour or two, and Aspen would just fling it all together and put it on YouTube. So it was fun though, but it genuinely felt like I was in NXT.
Yeah, I was genuinely, when the question answer one was there, I was sitting there going, how do they not know?
I remember one of them being like, oh, can you name all the Nexus members? And the only one I could name was Skip Sheffield, like, of all of the people. And that was the only one I could remember. But when you're put on the spot, it's very hard.
Can you do it now?
No. Skip Sheffield's the only one that comes into my head, and I don't know why. I don't know if that's a worrying thing, but, I mean, probably.
Oh, well, so that's name all the Nexus members out of the question lineup I've got here. Oh, it's so sad. I think I could probably still do it because I'm that kind of nerd. So we'll move on from wrestling a little bit, because right now in the last year or so, or just before lockdown hit, if I'm right in thinking, you started Ashley Vega Plays.
Yeah.
Where you did a little bit of well, I don't think it was that series initially. It was just you playing games on YouTube. So how'd you get into gaming? What was your first kind of console, and what got you into it?
The first console I had was a PlayStation 2 that my brother gave me. And the first game I got for it was SmackDown vs. Raw 2007, which is the first game I played on the channel, because I just loved it. I was so obsessed with the game. I would just play it every single day after school. And then I just got all the wrestling games for like the PS2, because all the games I have are mostly just my brother's when he was younger. I have an N64, a GameCube, just loads of old games and wrestling games that I like would just play in my spare time. And I was just like, oh, I should just like film this. Like, no, I had nothing to do during the first lockdown. I was so bored. And all I did was just like, I found all my old like consoles, like the PlayStation 2 and all that, and our cupboards, and I was just like, oh, I want to play all these games, like there's so many wrestling games. So me and my brother would play them, and then I was like, oh, I'm going to film this, like it'd be so fun to do it on YouTube. And that's how it all started.
So do you have video editing experience beforehand? It's just all stuff you've had to pick up on the way?
Yes, I'm absolutely awful at it. Special and first video is awful. Like, even I still can't do it. Like, I find it so hard. Like, I hate it. That's why I was wanting to start Twitch, because I enjoyed like filming them, but like I just had no editing experience, and they were so bad. Like the video quality, the mic quality. I spent so much money on new equipment recently, just so I could make better stuff. But the editing is still not quite there. So no.
I'm still impressed that when I go watch videos, because I have no editing prowess at all. This is like I said to you before I did this, and I've said to everyone else before I start recording, I top and tail this and hope that you don't want anything removed from it, because I don't really know how to. Yeah. So if it's not easy to do a Windows Movie Maker, I'm not doing it. But yeah, everyone went through a Twitch phase. Some have stuck to it during this lockdown. I did it for about a month, and then stuff happened, which meant that I couldn't use half of the people I made. So I was like, nah, this is it. I'm just going to move on. I'll do a podcast.
Yeah.
So if it's not Twitch, it's podcasting. So if you give up on the Twitch streaming, then this will be the next thing. It'll be Actual Vega speaks, and you'll be speaking to folk instead. What were your favourite wrestling games then? I know you had a couple, because I've been watching the videos as well, a couple that picked out, but any particular favourites?
My favourite one was purely because the story mode was so good. It was SmackDown vs Raw 2011. I thought the story modes, the road to WrestleMania, all of them were so fun, and I would still go over and play them all over, from start to finish. They were so fun. What other ones was there?
Is that the one with Mickey James out of story mode?
No, that was 2010. Ah. That one was good as well, but I feel like the 2011 one was much better. I can't remember who there was. You could go Christian, John Cena.
Of course.
And who else? Rey Mysterio. You know, they were just fun. Because in the Rey Mysterio one, you could either be face or heel. So there was two storylines for Rey, and that they were so fun. I loved that.
Hold them again, because I started every so often, if I found it like when game was still a thing, I would go in and start Game Station. Game's still a thing, but Game Station isn't. I would go in and just get there four for £20 or something like that, and end up picking up when that was the case. You can't see them because it's bloody.
Yeah.
But West Mountain versus Raw, here comes the pain and shut your mouth there. I forgot I even had them. I was just looking for something else in my parents' loft, and there they were, and I was like, oof, I'm taking you him. I've got PS3, I can play them on there. But no, I really need to get a hold of the old SmackDown versus Raws on PS3, because I remember them being so much fun.
They were all so good. But with the games now, I feel like they're very repetitive. And I think that's why I prefer the old ones, because to me, they're more fun. I think it just got really repetitive after, like, 2012. So I never play newer games. Like, I say, like, right now, I'm playing story mode on Bratz Forever Diamonds for the PlayStation 2. That is my gaming experience. I do not play Fortnite or any of this rubbish. It's not me.
I don't know how to. I downloaded it because it's free. So I was like, oh, I'll play a bit of this. I was just confused. It was like all these people building things. I'm looking, going, how? How do you do this?
Too much for me. It's too much for my brain to handle. Like, I see, like, Jason plays, like, Call of Duty, and I'm like, my brain can't comprehend to shoot someone that fast. Like, no.
Oh, yeah, I only ever bought it so I could play with my friends over, like, just...
Yeah.
Because we lived in different places, so we could all chat in the middle on Call of Duty. But outside that, I wouldn't bother playing it, because other people are too mean and just shot me.
Yeah, and people take it really serious, and I'm not about that, you know. I'd rather just, like, dress up and put makeup on my character, and that's it. Like, I love The Sims, that's why I love The Sims. Sims is a very good game.
Yeah, I started and finished, because it's a very quick game, Donut County, and it literally is, you're a hole, and you go around swallowing stuff. It lasts about 2 hours. It is the most fun I've had in ages. And my wife was watching that's it going, that was quite good. I'll play that as well. Because her gaming is Lego games and Tetris. Yeah. That's it. That's all she'll play. So she was just playing this Donut County Nate for ages. But I'm looking for games that are like Spyro, but not Spyro. That's my kind of wheelhouse. And Lego games, because they're amazing.
Yeah. Recently got the Nintendo Switch, and my favorite games were the Mario games. I have still the Wii, and I play all the old Mario games, the Mario games for the N64, amazing. I still have my Nintendo DS where I still play Super Mario Bros. Like, Super Mario Bros was my childhood. And I want to go to Japan and go to this whole thing, the Mario Land they've built, because that is just my dream. I don't know if you've seen it, but it looks unreal.
I think I've heard of it. I don't think I've seen it. I'll probably Google it after we're finished, because I'll have to see it. I don't know what it is. Mario, I remember playing when I was younger, and then when I played it more recently, I'm like, how? This is too hard. I don't get it. I don't understand.
Yeah, it's so hard. So my brother recently got the new game, which is like the new Super Mario's for the Switch. And I was playing it, and I was like, this is very difficult. How did I play this when I was younger and complete the full thing? And I can't play it now when I'm like, what are they doing? But it's so fun. And I spent so many hours playing Mario Kart when I was younger. Like,
yeah, I had the opposite experience with Streets of Rage. I'll be in the Emily Hayden podcast when I'm speaking to her about it. But yeah, when I played it younger, I was absolutely rubbish at it. Could not understand it. Got it on the PS3, completed it in 30 minutes, going, how? How did this take me so long when I was younger? So Bratz, that leads me to the next line of questioning. Stupid police thing. So Bratz seems to be something that you're very obsessed with, according to your Twitter. What is it about Bratz particularly that's caught your eye?
Well, I grew up with Bratz. I had hundreds, literally hundreds of all the Bratz dolls. The first movie I saw in the cinema was Bratz live action movie when I was like seven. It's like Barbie, but better. Like, Barbie is nothing compared to Bratz. People will come for me for saying that, but it's true. Like, boring people like Barbie, but bad bitches like Bratz. That's how you know. Like,
fair enough.
It's true. And I loved Bratz because it was so, I don't even know, like, even to this day, like, years later, I'm still playing all the games. And, you know, recently I paid £50 for the new, they brought out collector's editions of all the Bratz dolls, like the original five. And I was like, oh, I'm going to buy that because why not? And it's now on my shelf, still boxed. I just love collecting stuff. So I thought, you know, I'm going to treat myself to a Bratz doll that I'll never use.
I've started collecting stuff, much to my wife's chagrin, as you can see behind me. I have.
Yeah.
This initially, first couple podcasts was just that wall in the background. So it was just nothing. So I thought, oh, I'll put some stuff out. So I put out the wrestling belts because I'm a big saddle. Because I spotted your belt as I said that, thinking, why did I say that when you clearly have some as well? But no, I did that. I thought, oh, I've got some pops. I'll put them out as well. And now it's just gotten worse. And it's just...
I'm a big collector myself. I've got lots of pop figures as well. I've got all the Friends ones. Big fan of Friends. I have some wrestling ones. Not a lot, though. I've got lots of wrestling figures that I've got on my shelf as well, mostly just the boxed ones. I don't know if you remember the classic superstar figures that they brought out.
Yeah.
So I've still got Trish Stratus and Stephanie McMahon boxed.
Of course.
So I've got them on my shelf because they're the only two that I've got boxed. I've got loads of... I just love collecting things. That's another thing I think is so fun. I love buying, like... So I don't know if you can actually see it. Hold on. I bought the... Rock. Got that framed off the WWE store. Big, you know, mark, the Divas belt as well. Like, I'd love collecting things. It's, you know, my dream is to have, I talk about this all the time, I want like a bigger house because I want just one room to be like a gaming room, and I want all like memorabilia all over the room. That's just my dream.
Oh, yeah, absolutely, 100% into that as well. I've been told that if I want that, then I need to clear out the shed. I don't want to clear out the shed, so it's got to kind of weigh it up now. Do I clear out the shed and get my little game room, or do I just leave it and just expand my little office here until we have to go back to work and it all disappears? Yeah, it's I don't know why. I think it's just boredom now as well. I'm just like on eBay going, I ordered a Miz Pop on eBay last night because it was £5. And I was like,
why not?
Why not? You don't get them for £5. I'll order a Miz Pop.
Oh, you really don't. They're quite expensive. But I love collecting stuff. I like pops. What else do I collect? Like, I would still buy wrestling figures just to have. Mostly boxed ones. What else?
Yeah, I went through, I can't remember which interview I said it on, but I went through a whole day where I was determined I was going to collect all of the Spirit Squad figures. And I went to four or five shops, and I got them all. And they're all unboxed, wow. And they're in my parents' loft, and I need to find them because they're just God, amazing.
The Spirit Squad.
Oh, it's just incredible. It was a good day. I was like, I think I saw one of them. I saw, I don't know, Nikki, probably. And I was like, right, where else can I get them? And then I came home with all of them. I was so excited.
I've got lots of like wrestling badges and stuff, like in a box, just loads of pins and stuff that I'll never throw out because I'm such a hoarder. I don't need that, but I want to keep it. Like, I'm going to be such a bad person. Like, whenever I do clear outs, I do not throw anything out at all. I can't do it. I just can't let go of things. I'll just keep them forever for no reason.
Oh, yeah, but my catchphrase, if anything like that happens, is I'll go in the loft. Yeah. Everything goes in the loft. It's like anything that I just can't let go of, it'll go in the loft. It'll stay in this room until further notice.
I love collecting things. I love keeping things. There's so many like random rubbish that I don't need. I just keep them.
So outside of the Bratz dolls and probably that belt behind you, what would be your favourite bit of merchandise that you've got?
I don't know. Probably this belt because I spent a lot of money on it.
I know, they're pretty expensive things.
They're so expensive. I would have to say that. Or my Tristratus classic superstar figure. I don't really have anything else that's very interesting. Yeah, probably that belt. I'm obsessed with that. I've wanted one of them since I was literally like 8. I've always wanted that belt because I was like, oh my God, that's the best. And I asked for it every single Christmas when I was younger and never got it. I got the toy ones, and I'm like, that's not the one I want. Ungrateful child.
How dare you?
Yeah, but then I saw it on sale on the store. I didn't know they were still doing it. And I went on, I was like, oh my God, I didn't even think I just bought it. I was like, I can't, I need it, you know?
I was the exact same. I got my first proper belt for my 18th birthday, and I was so excited for it. Because I didn't know what it was, so I was told to go under their bed and pick out this box. It was a huge box. And pulled out it's the Undisputed Championship. It's on the floor, but it's so heavy, I'm not picking up. because, you know, I like showing off, because I'm sure you like yourself. You just like to just throw it over the shoulder and just go, yes.
What a classic.
Cool. I love it. And then after that, it's super heavy. But after that, I had disposable income and bought myself a cruiserweight belt, which is ironic, because I am not a cruiserweight by any stretch of the imagination. And a European title, because that was the one I always wanted. That and the big eagle. Actually, day when I can find a place to put it and not have someone else in this house try and throw it out, I will finally get myself a big eagle belt one day. Yeah. Right, okay, so I've got a list of... We haven't had 10 count in a while on these shows, so I'm going to just go through them in a second. Oh, what was it like teaming with Viper at SWA? Because I remember when you did an interview with me, like when we did the email ones, that was one people that you wanted to, well, you wanted to face Viper, but of course that hasn't happened, I don't think.
Yeah.
But you have teamed with her, so what was it like?
I forget, I'm bringing back memories here. I forget about all the stuff that's happened because it's been so long. But yeah. That was so much fun, and Lana and stuff were in that match as well. It was fun. She's so lovely. We had such a good match, and it was just fun, like wrestling with like loads of girls that you look up to. Like Jokey was involved as well, and it was such a good match. We all got on and we all had fun. So yeah, I think that's the main thing. We all had fun, and it was just SW is always fun. So it was good to do on that show.
I said I was going to do a top 10, but I'm not, because I started writing out other names that I had in my head and I've gone way past that. So we were talking about favourites. Obviously, you said the classics, all the ones that, the big names, Victoria. How cool was it seeing her return to the Royal Rumble?
Oh my God, so cool. So I always wanted her to return, and I thought she was going to do it maybe the one before or the first Women's Rumble they'd done. But she didn't, which was a letdown, because I saw like Tori and everyone coming back, and I was like, oh, Victoria has to come back. Like, she never did, but I'm so glad she did, because it was just amazing. And I really want to see her in the Hall of Fame as well. So
she has to. She's. I mean, I love Tori Wilson. I really do. But Victoria's definitely got a bit more of a resume to go into the Hall of Fame.
Definitely.
Right, so I'm just going to throw out some names at you. Just first thoughts, opinions, whatever. There'll be some that I know that you'll love. Ones you might not remember, but we'll go for it. So first one, of course, Candice Michelle.
Yeah, love her.
Has she replied yet to your tweets?
No, she's not. We're still trying. I literally sent her a DM on Twitter, which is so cringe. I sent her a DM with the post I put up with her, and loads of people were tagging her and things, but she never noticed. So gutted about that. I still love her. She's one of my favourites.
Jillian Hall.
Oh, Jillian. I've got a figure of Jillian, actually. She was so entertaining. She was one of those ones that just wasn't afraid to be stupid and like be different, not be this serious person all the time. She was just so much fun to watch.
She got an album into the UK charts, so I mean, you can't.
Talent.
Exactly. Michelle Bacool.
Oh yeah, Lay Cool were like so good. So they were like a big thing when I started watching, and I loved them. Lay Cool were like just the mean girls you wanted to be like. They were, yeah. Love Michelle.
But was a part of you when you got that belt looking at it going, but what if I'm able to
just slice it in half.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Do you remember Amy Webber?
Yes. The one who didn't have a match. Well, who was it she wrestled and they didn't turn up? Was it Don? No. Oh my God. Amy Webber. I'm going to look this up.
Amy Webber came around a bit. She was one of the advisors. I think she replaced Jillian Hall in JBL's cabinet, or vice versa. She was there first. Oh.
It was Joy Giovanni.
That was my next one. Joy Giovanni.
Yeah. Joy Giovanni, the one who has the lowest overall in like all of game history. I mean, fair enough, but
yeah, like, Joy Giovanni.
She was just fun. She was just there for a hot minute, you know. She just turned up and was like, hi.
Who's the other one? Who was like there was Joy, like right about that same batch, Joy, Michelle McCool, Amy Webber. I want to say it was called, she wasn't Candice Michelle, but she was called Candice something.
I should know this.
Hang on. It was Diva Search. I know that. It wasn't Christy Hemme. That was
going to be a pure nuisance, but I'm on 8%, so I'm going to quickly get my charger.
Cool. That's fine. I will go find I'll go find out who this person is. For everyone listening to the podcast now, this is just a research moment. Found her. Right. That doesn't sound... There we go. Ah, oh, no, it was here before. Okay, cool. Carmella. Jesus, she was only there for a hot second. This is 4G for sure.
Okay, did we find out who it was?
Cool. It was Carmella. Desiree.
Oh, yeah, close.
She had a lingerie pillow fight at Taboo Tuesday with Christy Hemme. So there you go for everyone who wants to go back and check that from 2004.
Go wild.
Yeah. So what would be your dream match then? We mentioned the gravy bowl. What would be your actual dream match? Who would it be against?
Oh, dream match. Trish Stratus or Mickey, because they were probably, like, wrestling wise my favourites. So yeah, one of them.
And what would be the match? Fulfill your fantasy battle.
Yeah. A serious wrestler, but in a crazy, stupid match.
That works. Right, so fan questions I've got here. I'll probably throw out more names as I go along, but fan questions. Gordon Jack, he said, my wee girl Isla has been able to watch Ashley a couple of times and has been lucky enough to meet you. She loves wrestling and going to shows. If she wanted to learn and begin training, is there anyone she would recommend? And if she wanted to look at other aspects like ring announcing, etc., where do you recommend going?
There's so many skills just now. And remember, Isla being quite young now. So I know Fierce Females have all women's class, which would be useful, especially for, you know, her age and things like that. All girls make her more, you know, comfortable starting off. And I know, like, pretty much any school, if you wanted to ever get into, like, ring announcing or anything, like, refereeing, you can always say that to whoever's there, and they'll always, you know, do their best to teach you that as well. You don't need to go to a training school and learn how to wrestle. You can do other things as well, which is why it's really benefit if you wanted to manage or anything like that. You can always be able to do that. So I would maybe say, you know, I think the Fierce Female School would be good for a young girl starting out.
Absolutely. Jason, who's probably hanging about just now, Jason Reed's asked, who is better at Wii Sports?
Me, because I won. We, almost every weekend, me and Jason play the Wii, and we play Wii Sports, and I always beat him at bowling. So me. He still owes me £100 because we had a bet on. So, still waiting for that because I bet on.
I mean, you can just get... I mean, they do the offers all the time on the WWE shop. You can just get an air belt to go next to him. That should be the next bet. Just get the actual Divas title.
Won't accept defeat. So...
Ricky Dodgerson. Well, actually, this is a two-parter because Judas Gray commented saying that he would beat you in a Gravy Bowl match. Which Ricky Dodgerson replied, what's your preferred brand of gravy?
KFC.
Ah, nice.
But Judas would not beat me in a gravable match. That guy has no clue. I'll do my homework. He doesn't.
You're born in the gravy, moulded by it.
Yeah.
Have you had the KFC Max's crisps that taste like the gravy?
No, I've not.
They're amazing. Actually,
but that might be something I need to try.
Yeah. I had them like last night and I was just like, they just taste like gravy. It's not right, but it's amazing. And Ian Skinner asked, I think we kind of covered it, but I'll let you go into more detail if you wish. Best SmackDown game?
2011 or the first one. Very first SmackDown vs. Raw.
Right, so we've got our silly questions before, unless we think of anything else before the end. But what's your favourite dinosaur?
I don't know any types of dinosaurs. I can't say their names. This is a dumb blonde moment, and I'm not blonde. I don't know any dinosaurs. A T-Rex?
T-Rex counts. I mean, you could have had Barney. You could have had Rex from Toy Story.
Oh, yeah, Rex. Definitely Rex. He's a T-Rex, so there.
True. Same. And this new question, which you may have heard because it seems to be a regular for folk down at the same kind of school area. What would win in a fight, two sheep or one cow?
What would win in a fight?
Yeah. Two sheep or one cow?
One cow.
Everyone says one cow. I think I've only had, like, two people say sheep. One of them was me. There was Krieger, who's put way too much thought into it in general. So, I just think two sheep would be a cow. Anyway. Right. So, as far as we'll go back to the wrestling bit for a little bit, and then we'll get your socials and have the rest of the evening. So, what's been your favourite matches yourself having? I mean, you mentioned a few of the ones like Veda and with Martina and what have you, but what's been your favourite match? Make it three if you want, just however many you want.
Yeah, okay. Top three. Angel Hayes at Discovery. My debut at Eve. And probably Veda as well.
And if once the world reopens and you're able to travel again, what would be the first? What companies do you want to try and check off your list in the next 12 months?
There's so many places I want to wrestle. I want to wrestle down at Eve again because I feel like when I did, it wasn't really me, and I've changed a lot since then. So I want to go down to Eve. A dream of mine is to wrestle in like the States, so I'd like to go to America, anywhere that will take me. So yeah,
awesome. And just for anyone that's, because during the last year and everything that went on, you're very open and about your own like journey in wrestling. Yeah. So if there's anyone like Isla, that wanted to get into wrestling, what would be a bit of advice you want to pass on to them?
Don't do it. No. If you ever wanted to start wrestling, research the school, make sure that it's safe and that you know the people there. Find a good school and you can't go wrong. That's all.
Short and sweet. Just out of thought, sort of popped into my head now. Your gear is very diva-esque. It's of course, you've got your Candace gear, your latest one, which is very much based off the Fulfill Your Fantasy Battle Royal. Yeah. Is that when the shows return, are you going to heavily lean into more of the diva side? Of course, you need a stink face as well. So is that a conscious thought when the shows return, just to kind of make it bigger and more diva gear?
I think I just want to go for it more. I've had so much time in lockdown to like think about things and sit about and do nothing and not being able to wrestle. I've been able to think about it a lot more. So that's why I got that gear, because I don't know any other girl that's doing it. I think it makes me stand out, because no other girl's going to come out and trust Stratus Fulfill Your Fantasy gear. And I don't want to look like everyone else. So that's why you did it.
That's it. It's gone from a point where divas were all over the place to now everyone wants to be a proper wrestler. It's like,
yeah, that's so the thing. Everyone looks the same. I'm not trying to like be a bitch, but I want to stand out, because I feel like, you know, everyone wants to be this wrestler and I just want to have fun. So that's why I do that.
That's exactly it. Because everyone remembers the girl with the glasses. That's the story that we can say about your journey. thank you very much for speaking to me today. I've really enjoyed it. With a little bit of technical hitch in between. I'm just saying that just in case I can't edit it out properly. So I'm telling people that there is a technical hitch. I think I've done all the questions there. And where can people find you on social media? Where can people find you?
All my social medias are at Ashley Vega UK, Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook. That's it.
Cool. Right. Before we go, though, tell us a story about your gear disappearing. Unable to use your gear. Was it your first match?
Yeah. Do you remember that? Was it?
It was on the Wrestle Gal podcast.
Oh. Yeah, it was one of my first shows. It was me and Angel Hayes. We were wrestling each other. I can't even remember what show it was. It was like a kids' show, and we were in the we wanted to get our own like changing area because we were the only girls on the show. So we went to the girls' toilets because we were like, oh, well, the show's not starting for a while and there's not going to be anyone here. So we went into the women's toilets and then they started letting all the fans in. And we could hear so many people coming into the toilet and we're like, oh my God. So we grabbed our gear, half naked, ran into a cubicle, both of us. We're trapped in this little tiny cubicle and I dropped my gear down the toilet. And I was like, I cannot believe I just did that. So I had to wear Angel's gear, half of her gear, and she's tiny. So I couldn't breathe, but I made it work.
Was that the like the pastely white and blue and
I had
pink?
That on the bottom half and then I had Angel's like black stuff with a t-shirt over it. It was a bad fashion day for me, but we move, the show must go on. Even if my gear smelled like, you know, was covered in cubicle water. Like it was disgusting, but
that's the story we're ending on. Perfect. So thank you very much for joining me. I'm looking forward to see what happens either on Ashley Vega Plays or if this beer / gravy bowl match ever happens. I'm telling you. Come on.
Alan, I'm coming for you.